you, everybody, for coming for this talk by Andrew Womack at Stanford. Andrew is a postdoctoral scholar in Chinese archaeology at the Stanford Archaeology Center and the Department of East Asian Languages and Cultures. Before coming to Stanford, he received his PhD from Yale University in 2017 and was a visiting faculty lecturer at McGill University in Montreal from 2017-2019. As Associate Director of the Tao River Archaeological Project, an international collaboration between Chinese and North American institutions, he coordinates research on the intersection of technological, social, and climatic change at late Neolithic and early Bronze Age. Nearly Bronze Age sites in northwestern China. Using a mixture of geophysical survey, excavation, and ceramic analysis, he's mapping the development of interaction networks that allow for some of the earliest transfers of goods and technologies between China and Central Asia along the Proto-Silk Road. Results from his research have been recently published in Antiquity, Asian Perspectives, Kaogu Wenwu, and GIS Reports. Please join me in welcoming Andrew.
Thank you very much for the Silk Road Center for inviting me out to give this talk. And thank you all for coming at the end of what I'm sure was a long. So this question of cultural change I've really been thinking about through my work in northwestern China, and also, you know, how sort of cultural interaction plays into this. And so I first became interested in this part of the world due to some outstanding questions in Chinese and Central Asian archaeology regarding the transfer of new technologies and goods into what is now northwestern China in the third millennium. And so we get things like sheep, goats, wheat, barley, and metalworking all showing up in what is today Gansu province in the mid-third millennium BC. And this goes on to have a pretty significant impact on the development of Chinese states. So, for example, metalworking makes its way from the northwest down into the central plain where it's reconfigured into bronze objects that are key ritual goods in early states. So people are familiar with like Shang and Zhou bronzes or vessels like that. These are thought to have been used for sacrificial purposes and also sort of prestige goods during this time. So had a relatively large impact there. And then these types of objects were further transmitted on and reconfigured down into Southeast Asia and also reconfigured into other materials. So for example, this turquoise inlaid bronze plaque, which is multiple of these have been found in the early Arli Toh state. These are also seen back in the Northwest. So there seems to be some clear interactions going on between both the steppe and northwestern China and northwestern China and central China during the third millennium. We also get other things coming back into the northwest from eastern China. So for example, jade carving and these interesting sort of tripod pottery vessels all end up showing up in this region as well. But the question that really motivated me for this research is how are these connections being formed? We see these objects moving around. We see these new domesticates and technologies coming in. But nobody is really been able to answer the question of how these connections were being formed, how these networks were actually functioning. What did this look like on the ground when people were interacting, and what impact did this have on people who were kind of in the middle of this? And so for my research, I focused on what is today southern Gansu province and surrounding areas of Qinghai, Sichuan, and Ningxia. And for the time period that I'm looking at, is, as I mentioned, the third millennium BC, but really from about 3200 to 1500 BC. And in Chinese archaeology, this time period has been broken up into two major cultures, as they're often called. And so the earlier one is referred to as Ma Jia Yao, from 3200 to 2000 BC, and the later one is Qi Jia, from 2300 to 1500. And these are the only two key Chinese terms that I'll be using throughout this talk, so I'll try to just refer to things as Ma Jia Yao and Qi Jia. Within the Chinese archaeological literature, Ma Jia Yao has been broken down into various subphases, again, based on pottery typology, but I won't go into that too much in order to keep things straightforward here. So looking at these two, again, cultures that I'm going to do with air quotes repeatedly, the main division was initially based on pottery. And so, as in many parts of the world, archaeologists would rely on typologies of pottery vessels to try to both categorize ancient cultures, since we don't have any writing or anything, and also to look at cultural change. And so if you look at these pottery vessels, there's clearly a real difference between these two periods. So Ma Jia Yao pottery is typically characterized as being painted with these beautiful geometric motifs. They also made coarseware pottery too, but most of the literature really focuses on these fine, highly painted vessels. These show up over a relatively wide area. And the painting, with some changes, persists, as I showed earlier, for more than 1,000 years. Now, during the Qijia period, there's a real change in what vessels look like. Painting almost entirely disappears. Vessels are typically much smaller, they're plainer. To some people's eyes, they're more rudimentary. And indeed, the first archaeologists who encountered these actually thought Qijia was the older culture and that Ma Jia was the more recent one. And so this actually occurred back in the 1920s with J.G. Anderson sitting there on the right, who was a Swedish geologist. And if people are familiar with the history of early Chinese archaeology, Anderson was everywhere. So he worked for the Geological Survey of China, and he and his Chinese colleagues not so much discovered, but brought to light or published about many Neolithic sites across the country. So things like Yangshao, and he was also in the Northwest naming cultures like Ma Jia and Qijia. And so Anderson, when he saw these pots at sites that he was visiting in the Northwest, said, you know, these Qijia pots, they look pretty roughly made. They're not these beautiful artistic works like Ma Jia. They must be older, and then Ma Jia developed out of that. Since then, Chinese archaeologists have explored more sites in the region, and of course, from stratigraphy, found that no, Ma Jia actually is older. Qijia is more recent and clarified that chronology. But nevertheless, this idea of cultural change corresponding with this change in pottery has really persisted even to the present day in Chinese archaeology. And so looking back at the region that's covered by this, archaeologists have, since the 1920s, continued to work in this region to try to better understand sort of the wider nature of these two cultures of Ma Jia and Qijia peoples. So looking at how they were living and what was going on, what changed between these two periods. And so there's been a relatively small number of sites that have actually been excavated in this region. Here this map is showing just sites that have habitation areas that have been excavated. So we have a few more cemeteries that have been excavated that I don't have on this map, but really a relatively small number of sites have been thoroughly excavated in this area. So as you can see, you know, just a very small handful of Qijia sites and a slightly larger number of Ma Jia sites. But this is really leaving us in a tough spot as far as understanding how Ma Jia and Qijia peoples were living and what sort of changes were occurring. And so to try to tackle those questions, archaeologists have relied on a few different sources of information. And so one of the first things that archaeologists have looked at traditionally in this region is site distribution. So where are we actually finding sites that belong to these two cultures? And so every few decades, the archaeological institutes and cultural relics institutes in each province publish maps of all of the archaeological sites that are known. And so you see there's a lot more sites, you know, all the red dots there, there's a lot more sites known on this map than I showed on the last one. So these are not sites that have been excavated. Most of these were discovered accidentally, so with farmers working in their fields and finding pottery or construction projects running into graves or things like that. And when this happens, generally it's reported to a local official who then reports it to a local archaeologist who then reports it to a higher-up archaeologist, and then they send somebody out to take a GPS point and look at the pottery and give the site a cultural affiliation based on the pottery and that sort of it. That's how you get this sort of map. But nevertheless, hundreds and hundreds of sites have been mapped in this way. And so this is the site distribution we have for the earlier Ma Jia period. And this is the site distribution we have for the later Qijia period. And so a number of scholars in China have looked at these and started trying to correlate them with other data to understand what's going on in this change between periods. And so one major line of inference has been based on climatic data. And so there have been people taking things like lake cores in Qinghai, lake cores in Gansu, ice cores up on the Tibetan Plateau. And they've noted that around 2000 BC, there was a significant cooling and drying of the climate in this region. And so when archaeologists were looking at these site maps, they had this in mind and saying, you know what, during this time period, we see more sites in southwestern Gansu. And if people are familiar with China, this area is Qinghai, so we're getting into the foothills of the Tibetan Plateau here. This area of Gansu is quite mountainous, and so you're gradient up as far as elevation goes. And we see more sites at a higher elevation during the Ma Jia period. Then if you look at this Qijia map, there's more sites further east, and this is at much lower elevations. And so based on these site distributions, a number of archaeologists have put forward the idea that, you know, maybe climate change was partially driving the shift in sites in this larger cultural shift between the Ma Jia and Qijia period. The climate got cooler and drier, people couldn't live at such high elevations, they couldn't grow crops at such high elevations, and that's why we see this change occurring. So that's sort of one major line of inference that has been posited for this cultural change that was going on between the two periods. The other major line of inference is regarding pottery, and so I will briefly jump back to the pottery slide. So this Qijia period pottery is actually quite similar to some pottery we see further east in central China, just before the Qijia period. And so the other major line of inference is based on pottery and saying, you know, we see more sites in the east because there must have been a migration from further east of people moving into Gansu and bringing their pottery with them. And so these sort of dual explanations of climate change and migration are what have really driven most hypotheses regarding this cultural or so-called cultural change in Gansu. But recently there have been more evidence that people have been trying to add to this argument. And so, for example, they've also looked at subsistence practices. Now, if people are familiar with Chinese archaeology, excavations that focus or that even record or that do flotation, which is a method you use to get seeds out of the soil that you're excavating, have only really been undertaken in relatively recent times. So a lot of the sites excavated in the 60s, 70s, 80s, we don't have any archaeobotanical data for. We don't know anything about the seeds and crops that were being eaten at those sites. But now we're starting to get more and more of that. And generally what's been posited is that during this earlier Ma Jiayao period, people were subsisting primarily on millet farming. And during the late Neolithic period in China and the north, millet is by far the staple crop at almost every site. So we see two types of millet, broom corn and foxtail. It seems like preference varies depending on where you were living. Some people just like broom corn millet better. Some people like foxtail millet better. But either way, this was by far the dominant crop. As far as how it was eaten, a lot of people have proposed porridges, but we had one really lucky find at a site, actually from the Qijia period, a site called Laja, where they uncovered a bowl that was turned over at the site. The site was covered by a mudslide, actually, and there were these noodle remnants below it. So we know people were eating noodles in the late Neolithic period. And these were, in fact, millet noodles when they did some analysis on them. So I think these currently have the oldest noodle in the world tag attached to them. But we'll see if the Italians can. A lot of focus on the Ma Jiayao period of the dominance of millet in the diet. However, we also know, thanks to people who are mapping and dating seeds and mapping as their new domesticates are moving across Central Asia, that we start to get some new items coming in. So as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, wheat and barley start to show up in China at this time as well. So wheat and barley were both domesticated in Western Asia, seem to make their way across the steppe, and then arrive in northwestern China during the Ma Jiayao period. So the earliest seeds we find of wheat and barley in northwestern China are actually from this earlier Ma Jiayao period, but we only find them in very small amounts. And during the later Qijia period, based on some isotopic studies that have been done, there have been arguments that Qijia people were incorporating wheat and barley more heavily into their diet. And so the explanation for this, again, has followed a bit along this climate change argument, that the climate, as it got cooler and drier, forced people living in this region to change up what crops they were growing, since wheat and barley are typically they're easier to grow in cooler weather than millet is. And so that's the second line of evidence that some archaeologists have used to argue that climate change is really driving not only this change in where people were living, but also in what they were farming. Another line of evidence also comes from subsistence practices, but this time with domesticated animals. And so generally in northern China during the Neolithic period, we see two major domesticated animals at sites. By far the most common one is pigs. Everybody loved eating pig apparently during this time period, and you see pig bones at sites, again, across all of northern China during the Neolithic. The other thing, you have domesticated dogs. These are generally much lower proportions. Sometimes they appear to have been eaten, but not always, so it wasn't like they were a main staple of the diet. Pigs was basically it, and if anybody's been to China today, you know, pork is still by far the most popular meat there. But again, during the Ma Jiayao period, we start to have some new domesticates coming in, again from domesticates that were initially domesticated in Western Asia. So we get sheep-goat. So sheep and goat are notoriously hard to differentiate from their skeletons. Seems like we're probably mostly getting sheep, but also potentially some goat coming in, and these are definitively domesticated, so probably being brought in again from the steppe regions. We also get some cattle coming in. Again, somewhat difficult to differentiate between domesticated and wild cattle during this time period, but it seems like we're just doing more ancient DNA work to try to sort this out. But it seems like we're definitely getting some domesticated cattle coming in during the middle Manchayao. And then finally, there's a lot of debate about horses. I didn't even put a picture of a horse on here because it's so debated. I just put a much later bronze horse from another part of northern China. There's been a lot of questions about when horses, and especially domesticated horses, arrive in the Northwest. The best answer is we really don't know still. You see a few bones at Qijia sites, but they're also notoriously difficult to know if they're domesticated or not. So horses, I should just put a big question mark there. But definitely sheep and cattle we get coming in. And the Majiao. And then again, it's been proposed that they're increasing at Qijia sites so that we have this move not only towards wheat and barley and towards lower level sites, but also potentially a move towards a more pastoral lifestyle. So less centered on pigs and more centered on herds of of sheep and cattle that you would potentially move around with. And this line of evidence has been reinforced somewhat by looking at the very few layouts of excavated sites we have from these two time periods. So again, there's only been a small handful of excavated sites or living like habitation sites from the Majiao and Qijia periods. And generally, they look pretty similar. So the red outlines here are all house structures. Houses at the time were semi-subterranean wattle and dub architecture houses, so there's no actual like house remains left to see. You just see kind of an outline in the ground. And generally, they're sort of scattered around in groupings, which you can see a little bit better on this map. Usually, there's some graves in among the houses. Sometimes, there's a separate cemetery. Sometimes, you have kilns, which are outlined in yellow there, near the houses. Sometimes, they're far away. There seems to be kind of a mishmash of how you're laying out your site that varies almost as much geographically as it does between the two time periods. But then, interestingly, during the Qijia period, we get some new structures we haven't seen before at a few of the excavated sites. And these are actually stone circles on the ground. And archaeologists have proposed a couple uses for them, again, relating to herding. So one is that maybe this is where you would keep your sheep at night when you bring them back to your campsite. And I mean, these stones aren't very big, so I think they're proposing that there were posts or something to go along with them to make fences. Or alternatively, some archaeologists have suggested that maybe these are where you would pitch your tent, and that Qijia people were actually much more pastoral, with some groups actually being almost full-time herders who moved around in tents, while others remained farmers. These, again, are far from proven hypotheses, but these are just some of the ideas that people have put forward regarding this transition and seeing it not just as a transition in pottery styles, but as a full transition in life ways, towards more herding, towards more diverse crops, towards living in different locations. Speaking of other technological imports, another thing that arrives, along with the sheep and the goats and the cattle and the wheat and the barley, is metallurgical technology. And so metallurgical technology first shows up in northwestern China as far as securely dated sites go. And generally what we get there are relatively small portable objects, which is not entirely surprising. We get things like bronze knives, rings, mirrors, small decorations. So these things are all about, you know, this big, not very particularly large. And again, these arrive first in the Majiao period, but from that whole period, we have maybe a dozen of these objects. And then suddenly in the Qijia, we're getting into hundreds of these objects. So still not a massive amount, and we're not seeing them sort of reconfigured in the way that we get in central China into vessels and things, but certainly being used. We now have what is proposed as the earliest bronze smelting site in the Northwest, which is in northern Gansu province and dated tentatively to the Qijia period. And so there's been a proposal that metallurgy sort of first appeared in the Majiao period, but that it was all imports, that nobody was making it locally. And then we get this transition in the Qijia period to actual local production of bronze. Now, one thing that hasn't been brought up is why people would necessarily start using this. Yes, they're useful tools, but is it worth really all the effort to make metal? And that's something that hasn't really been proposed. But again, this is seen as feeding into this being a really big transition and a major technological transition between the two periods. Sort of the last line of evidence that people talk about in discussing this transition is mortuary data. And so during the Majiao period, most burials look like what we see in the center here, where you have a single inhumation surrounded by a few pieces of pottery. This person has slightly more than usual, maybe 10 or 12 vessels. Usually you get, you know, 3 to 10 vessels, and that's about it in your grave. Maybe a stone tool here or a, you know, shell decoration there, but not too much going on. And mostly all the graves look like this. So they're relatively straightforward. There's not a lot of differentiation. During the late Majiao period, in some areas, you do get this more elaborate burials where people will have dozens or maybe even up to 100 pots in a grave. So there's been some proposals that in the late Majiao period, things were becoming more unequal. But everybody's still getting the same type of good. It's just pottery and basic stone tools. During the Chijia period, that changes a bit. So most graves still look like what we see in the upper left-hand corner of that illustration there, single people and a burial with a few pots. But at some cemeteries, we start to see some more unusual objects. And so it's a little bit dark on the bottom. This person in that burial there actually has a coffin around them, and then also has some pieces of carved jade that were around their neck and head. And so we start to see these objects that are much more associated with the Neolithic in northern and central China, carved jade, more elaborate bronze items. And then also, in some cases, it's been proposed, if you look at those upper right skeletons, that maybe even human sacrifice was occurring, where you would have somebody else being put in the grave next to you. That's very highly debated, but several people have again made this argument that we're seeing major cultural changes going on from these relatively egalitarian pottery-focused burials of Ma Jiao to having more elaborate exotic items and possibly even human sacrifice during the Chijia period. And so just to recap, the changes that have traditionally been proposed, we see major changes in pottery forms and decorations. Site layouts are similar, but perhaps with some new types of buildings. We see potential changes in subsistence with increases in barley and wheat and sheep and goats and cattle during the Chijia period. We see potential changes in mortuary practices. And also it's been proposed that there was more long-distance exchange during the Chijia period, and that accounts for this increase in like jade objects and bronze objects and things like that. And so it was with this big change in mind that I wanted to sort of find out what was going on a more local scale. Because again, most of these results are based on sites that are very widely spread across the Northwest that are not particularly well dated in many cases. And so I felt that my colleagues and I felt that it would be better to really focus on a very specific geographic location to try to better understand on a local scale what technological and social change, or lack of social change, or lack of change, really looked like. And so to do that, we started the Tao River Archaeological Project. It is a collaboration between archaeologists at Harvard University, Beijing University, and the Chinese Academy, or sorry, and the Gansu Institute of Archaeology. And we focused our research on the Tao River, which I'll show you in just a second on a larger map, but it's here in southern Gansu province. And we were particularly interested in this region because it has a lot of sites in it, and it's been looked at for a relatively long time, but not that many sites that were actually excavated. And so this project started 9 years ago, and we spent the first couple of years of the project just going around and visiting sites in the Tao River. And there were over 500 known sites in this region. This is also where Anderson first was working in the 1920s. So there's been a long history of at least archaeological visits to this area. And so we spent the first 3 years visiting sites, sort of seeing which ones were the most conducive for archaeological research, which ones were really intact. Out of that, we picked 23 sites that we thought were promising and then applied for permits from the national government, which we received a few years later. A few years takes a long time to get permits for international projects in China, but it is possible. And with that, we settled on, so we had these 23 sites that we could work at, and we've worked at six so far. And the four on here are ones where I've done particular research, but really Qijiaping and Daiato are the main ones that I'm going to focus on today. Here you can see the Tao River. Next to the Yellow River of Niamangjo, then flows south through Gansu and starts at the edges of Qinghai. So what do we do at these sites? So our questions really were focusing on what was going on immediately before, during, and after this Chijia period. So when do we actually see new technologies arriving? What levels are they actually incorporated at? Are people like really getting on board with incorporating sheep into their diet and growing wheat and barley, or is it something that just sort of like is there for a little bit and dies out? What's going on with that? Because we really don't know on a local scale what's happening. And then my own personal interest was what's going on as far as connections between sites. So we know these things are coming in from really far away, this metalworking and sheep and whatnot, or somehow arriving here, but we really don't have any idea of the relationships between communities that were potentially underpinning these connections. So it's not like somebody was getting on a horse necessarily on the steppe, riding 2,000 miles and dropping a sheep off in the Tao River Valley. Something else had to be going on. So I was also very interested in examining these connections. After that, we visited, as I mentioned, five of the sites and undertook surface survey. So for non-archaeologists in the crowd, this involves systematically walking over a site area. And when I say site, I mean basically an area where there's a scatter of pottery on the ground. That's literally what sites look at like in this area. There's no architecture or anything like that. You just see broken pottery all over the place. So the first thing we wanted to do was sort of quantify how much broken pottery is there. What type of pottery are we seeing? What's going on? And so basically we walk around systematically across the fields. We take a GIS program and an iPad and digitize the fields as we go, and then we can calculate how many pieces of pottery are we finding in each field, what types of pottery are we seeing, what time periods are they coming from. And from that, we're able to make density maps of the artifacts showing up at these sites. And so, for example, at this site from the Majayao period, if you look at that white part in the center compared to that chart, some of these sites are extremely dense with pottery. So that's like 400 pieces of pottery per square meter on the ground in some of these sites. So basically, you couldn't walk over the middle of this without crunching it underneath your feet, which is probably why there were so many pieces. Very small. But yeah, so there's a lot going on above the ground of these sites as far as just artifacts scattered everywhere. So we use that to sort of better understand where people were potentially living in the past, because theoretically they're breaking the pottery around their house or throwing it in trash pits near where they were living. So this can give us a better idea as to where we want to target further investigations. So along with surface survey, I also undertook what's called magnetometry survey. And basically this involves using an instrument called a magnetometer that I'm holding here and systematically walking over the site. And so the outline, everything outlined in blue there are areas, let's see if I can get a cursor here, areas where I conducted the survey. And what a magnetometer does is it detects very subtle changes in the Earth's magnetic field that are directly below the ground. And so these changes can be caused by all sorts of different things. They can be caused by metal objects, for example, giant telephone poles, which are what these three dots are and this other dot up here. So they can be caused by modern objects like that, but they can also be caused by archaeological materials. So for example, things like the remains of ancient hearths or kilns or trash pits or ditches even will show up in this type of survey. And so if you're looking at the middle of this map, you can see that it's just pockmarked black and white. Those are all features that are caused by archaeological material below the ground. So this was a very densely inhabited sites over the years. Unfortunately, what this doesn't tell you is how old things are. So you can get a pretty good idea by the magnetic signature of what something is, but you don't know how old it is. And so we used hand augers, which basically make a little hole in the ground, to auger these features to try to understand what they are. And then we also dated when we would pull up things like charcoal from them. We dated that to confirm that at least this portion of the site up here, this is early Majayao and then middle Majayao and perhaps some Chicha as well in this area. So that allowed us to get a better understanding of the site layout. And through sort of analysis of those results, we figured out that this, what looked like one gigantic Majayao site, was actually probably like at least five different occupations that were next to each other. Some of them were actually divided up by ditches that are typical in the Neolithic for, we think, defense or keeping wild animals out or potentially keeping herd animals in a site. So we were able to determine that actually this was not some gigantic site. It was actually a bunch of sites that were probably on top of each other. And then based on dating, we figured out that it looks like if the occupations weren't concurrent, but they seem to have been maybe continuous, so you might live in one area for a while and then eventually move over to another area of the site. We've done some more recent dating, which we're waiting for the results from, so we're hoping to have a better idea of actually how this evolved over time, but that's sort of our initial assessment of it. The other thing magnetometry is very helpful with is targeting your excavations. So we didn't have the time or the resources to excavate large chunks of the site. We really wanted to focus in on specific discrete features. And so, for example, up here on the left, in cattle B, you can see there's a very black sort of amorphous shape. And that's a, let's see, it's right here on a grid, so this is relatively small. So that's what we would call an anomaly in the magnetic survey. We augered that, saw that it looked like it was probably some sort of trash pit. And then when we excavated, that photo next to it is our final excavation photo that's been superimposed in the GIS on top of the anomaly, and it pretty much exactly matched. So this allowed us to very specifically target certain features and excavate those so we wouldn't be wasting our time just digging empty soil. And so we undertook excavations at several different sites. There's our intrepid students working in the field, so we have both Chinese and American grad students and undergrads, and some Canadians as well joining us on this project. And then we would analyze the results. So we would do initial macro analysis, so just recording the size, the weight, other notable features of these artifacts. Back in Lanzhou, so we had everything from oracle bones. People are familiar with these. You might be more familiar with the oracle bones from the Shang Dynasty, which actually have the earliest Chinese writing on them. It's a much older tradition of burning bones to try to understand the future. And then we also have some other things like stone tools, bone tools, and of course, a lot of pottery, and a lot of pottery. And so my personal research really focused in on the ceramics that we were getting from these excavations. As people have written for many years about the beautiful Magiao ceramics and how amazing they are and how wonderful they look, and in some cases how similar they might be to ceramics that are way across in other parts of Asia and Europe. But there had actually been very few studies regarding how these were made, what they were used for, whether they were exchanged. The exchange studies that had been done were very ambiguous, just talking about very large-scale potential exchange. There was only one study of how these were even potentially made. So we really knew very little about these objects and very little about the people that were making them, how they were being used, if they were being moved around. And those were some questions that I thought were pretty important to answer regarding both sort of craft production and social organization, but also interaction between sites. And so to try to answer those questions, I used a method called ceramic petrography. And this involves taking a selection of sherds, cutting off a little piece of them, attaching it to a glass slide, polishing that down so that light passes through, and then looking at it under a petrographic microscope. And basically what this allows you to do is see what kind of recipes potters were using when making their pottery. And so, is anybody a potter in here? Just curious. No potters. Okay, I can say whatever I need to. Just to introduce, when you're making pottery, depending on what you're going to make, you're going to generally use a different recipe of clay. So if you're going to make a very nice vase, maybe for drinking water out of or storing something in, you're probably going to make that out of relatively pure clay. And it's going to give you a nice surface finish that you can, you know, decorate or do whatever you need to. If you're making a pot that you're cooking with, you don't want really nice pure clay, because if you don't have anything else in that clay, that pot's going to break apart, either explode in the kiln or break apart after you cook with it a few times due to the thermal stress. So what you want to do is add some other stuff in there to keep your pot from breaking. So people would add in sand. In other parts of the world, people would add in shell or hair or all sorts of things. It's amazing what you can see in some pots. But in this region, people generally added sand. And so they would use a mixture of local clay and sand to make their cooking pots, or just local clay to make their other non-cooking pots. And interestingly, this can tell us a lot about where pots came from and how they were made. So generally, people would often add, you know, use local clay resources, add local sand. And so I was examining and able to look at the different recipes people were using. And a lot of times, yeah, people did use local clay. So this fine paste pottery that's an example A, very nice pure local clay. I can even show you where it comes from on the next slide. Or they would use this sort of feldspar quartz inclusions. And this is basically local river sand that people were adding to their pottery. But then I have all these other groups that are made up of stuff that you don't find around these sites. And I know you don't find them around these sites because I looked. So I did some geological survey. I consulted geological maps for the region I work in. And I also talked to local potters who live in this area today to ask them where they got their clay. And so Mr. Yu there on the right is showing us his clay source that's actually right above one of the archaeological sites that we work at. And that's actually the clay that very closely matches, unsurprisingly, a lot of the pottery that was made there. And so to sort of understand what was going on in these both geological sources and recipes, when I was examining these samples under the microscope, I was looking at two things. One of them, as I just showed, was sort of what types of minerals were being used to make this pottery. So what types of local sand were people putting in their clay, or was naturally occurring in the clay? The other thing I looked at is how much stuff was in there. And that's what this chart here on the left is displaying. So the bottom left-hand corner, it's a little small here, it says matrix. That basically just means clay. So how much of the sample is just pure clay? In the top, there's not a label, but it's silt. Silt is like very, very fine particles that are generally naturally occurring in clay. And so something that's at the bottom left of this chart is made of just pure clay. The further up it is, it means there's more silt in it. And the further right it is means the more sand or temper, the more big particles are in it. And so by combining the assessment of what minerals are in it with the proportions of sand and silt and temper, you can really get a pretty good idea of where this stuff is coming from, either on the landscape or at least understanding what different recipes were being used. And so now I'm going to talk a little bit about the recipes that I was seeing in pottery from the Magiao and Qijia period. So first off, just to show you what this looks like on a site scale. So here are all the samples I took from a Majayao settlement site. And I sort of classified these before I looked at them into pottery that I thought was like coarseware, stuff that would be used for cooking, versus fineware, stuff that would be used for storage or drinking. And then I had some plain unpainted stuff too. And generally, when you're looking at this chart, what I thought was fineware was pretty fine. So it has a range of silk in it, but it's mostly clay, not much other sand or temper. And then the stuff I thought was coarseware was pretty coarse. So it had a relatively large amount of sand in it, 20, 30, 40% in some cases. And it divides out nicely from the fineware. Now, I did make a few mistakes. I don't know how I classify this as fineware. It's got a lot of stuff in it. But mistake on my part there. So when I was actually analyzing, after I had done the analysis, so I analyzed all my samples as a group. I didn't want to know where they came from, what type of pot they were. I did it all independently in that way. And then I just broke down the results by what type of pottery we were looking at. And so, for example, this is all the painted pottery from this Majayao settlement. And basically what this chart is showing is that there's not a whole lot of variation in what we're seeing here. So it's mostly blue dots. That's all stuff that's made with very pure clay. We've got a cup, and it basically falls within about a 10% range, which is essentially the amount of variation you'll get when you're doing a study like this. And so all these blue dots are probably from a single pottery, like a single clay source. There's also going to be some variation by potter's preparation of this material. And then we've got a couple outliers up here. These might be a slightly different clay source. They don't have any different minerals in them, but they do have more silt, so it might be something nearby. But I didn't find anything that actually matched that stuff. Then we have a couple little outliers, red and green dots. These are things that they fall into the same sort of general area as the blue dots, but these had some different minerals in them, and so I know they don't necessarily come from nearby because they have some minerals that we're not seeing right there. But generally the impression that I got was the painted stuff that we are finding at this habitation site made at this habitation site, or at least made by people right by it and then sort of used universally there. And this was quite different, actually, from what I saw at a nearby cemetery. So I was able to sample some pottery from a cemetery that dates to the same period as the Majayao habitation site we just looked at. It's about 20 kilometers away. This cemetery was actually excavated in the 1970s, but they didn't excavate all of it, and it's been looted, unfortunately, since then. But this allowed me to go to a looted part of the site and pick up sherds and then use them for the samples. So these are actually all from a single tomb. And as you can see, it looks quite different from what we're seeing at the habitation site. So we do have, again, some blue dots in this around like 5 to 10% silt range. This is, again, probably stuff that was made locally with the local clay source I identified. But then unlike the habitation site, we actually have a lot of variety. So we have all these red dots in here, which is clay with clay pellets in it. This is something that you do not see locally, so that must be coming from somewhere outside of this sort of general site area. You also have some other red, green, orange dots up here. These are probably all recipes that are coming from other areas, so not necessarily being produced by local potters. And I thought this was really interesting, that it's at the funerals where we're seeing what appears to be a lot of exchange or a lot of different pottery coming from other areas into this single site. And so I started thinking more about this and looking at the archaeological literature on funerals, thinking about funerals that I had been to. And to me, this really started to make sense, because when you go to a funeral, often you're going somewhere, if it's a family member or, you know, a distant friend who maybe you don't see that often, one time you're going to go there is for a funeral. And what do? At least if you're from the Midwest / South like I am, you take a casserole with you. And so there's lots of ethnographic and archaeological literature on the commensality of funerals and how people come together. They bring pottery, they bring the contents even more importantly, so things like alcohol or foods, and often they'll leave it there afterwards. And so I think what we might be seeing reflected in this data here is people coming together from multiple communities, potentially at funerals, bringing pottery with them and leaving it there. And when you look at the whole vessels from these cemetery as well that were excavated back in the 70s, you see a lot of variation. So I didn't have time to present the data, but I did a whole study on whole vessels that were excavated from the cemetery, and there is a huge range of both decorative motifs and the quality of production and the life histories of the vessel. They really look like they're coming from a whole different variety of uses and contexts. And so this really made me think about, you know, how are people coming together? How are interactions between communities being built? And it seems like funerals might have been one way that we see those interactions occurring. So getting back to finewares in general. Now we're going to look at a comparison to the slightly later Qijia period, so about 800 years later, but in the same area. And I didn't have a separate, really, cemetery selection from this Chijia site. The site does have a cemetery, but when I looked at pottery from across the site, it was all very similar, so I'm just going to be looking at habitation material right now. And basically what I saw was there wasn't a whole lot of change going on in the fine wares between this earlier and later period. So again, lots of blue dots on the left-hand side of this chart perfectly matches the local clay that's available in the region. So it looks like most pottery was still being made locally on site with the local clay. Now we do have some more red and green dots out there. This makes me think that maybe there was more exchange or a slightly higher level exchange going on with other sites where this material that was either being collected somewhere else and then brought to the site to make pottery, or they were actually exchanging for pots that were made somewhere else was coming in. But generally quite similar in the types of materials and the recipes that were being used for fineware pottery, despite the pots themselves looking quite different. I think this is even more striking when we look at coarseware, so things that would have been used to make cooking pots between these two periods. If you look at these charts, sorry, I know the writing is a little bit small, but in both of them, blue dots in the center are dominant, and these blue dots here are what I call feldspar quartz type of paste recipe, and basically this is what happens when you, at least based on some experiments I did, take the local clay and then put a handful of river sand in it from the river that's right next to these sites, is you get these essentially blue dots. So I think people were using the local recipes for this. But there does seem to be a lot of exchange for cooking pots, and I really don't know why this was. I mean, cooking pots do break more often, so maybe you would exchange more often for them when they were breaking. I'm really not sure. But the really striking thing to me about these two charts is that there is continuity in all of the outline or like unusual paste recipes that we see between these two periods. So during both periods, blue dots dominate, so this local made stuff appears to dominate continually over 800 years. But then the other types of pottery that were coming in are exactly the same. So we see exactly the same types of outlier paste groups. So either potters or people living in these communities were trading with the same other communities that continued over this time, or they were going out and gathering these other resources and using them. But either way, it was very clear that there was a lot of continuity in the way, in the paste recipes that were being used, in the way that these vessels were being made. And so this really made me start to think more about this proposition that Chijia was some completely different entity than Ma Jiayao, that there was this huge change going on, because that's really not what we see in the ceramic technology or in the relationships, the exchange relationships that seem to be illustrated by this technology. And so this made me think, what if we look a little closer at other aspects of Ma Jiayao and Chijia society on this more local scale? And so one thing I looked at was local site distribution. So I showed you those big site distribution maps earlier from the two periods that showed this real clear shift from being further west to further east from the Ma Jiayao to Chijia period. But I had access to site data for the Tao River area. And when I put these two, made these two charts and put them next to each other, I thought I had made a mistake because they looked so similar at first. There are some differences, but really, a lot of these sites, and then I went through the individual site data and was like, oh, so many of these were occupied during both periods. So there were actually tons of sites that were, if not continuously occupied, were at least reoccupied during the Chijia period after being occupied during the Ma Jiayao period. But a lot of them seem to be almost continuous occupation in the same locations. We do have more sites during the Chijia period in this upper Tao River area, which interestingly is actually at a higher elevation, which really goes against this idea of people moving towards lower elevation sites. So I was thinking, oh, well, we don't see a huge change in the pottery, and at least in this region, we don't see a huge change in site locations either. And then we have just very recently gotten in some other results from our archaeobotanical analysis, so analysis of seeds and also zooarchaeological analysis. This was just sent to me like last week, so new breaking data coming out here. And so we've done archaeobotanical analysis on our excavations at both the Ma Jiayao and Chijia site. And the Ma Jiayao site, oh man, so many things are too small on this, sorry. Basically the bars at the bottom right are showing for each of the excavation units that we dug, or each of the features that we dug at this Ma Jiayao site, what kind of seeds are we getting out? So we would take all the soil, dump it in a giant bin of water with a mesh in it. Our kind archaeobotanist, Fabian Toro, spent hours and hours and hours by this trash can full of water just churning it with his hands to get these seeds out. But anyway, we got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of seeds that he's gone through recently. And basically on that chart, everything in purple and green is millet. So millet is by far dominating. That sort of teal color at the top is wild plants or seeds from wild plants. And then this chart up at the top left is actually showing the wheat remains. So out of all of those units, only five of them had wheat or barley in them. The blue and red is wheat, the green is barley. But they are showing up. So, and this is pretty much all material that we're pretty sure is middle Magi-Yao period. So wheat is definitely coming in, but it's at a relatively low level. Now we also had a different archaeobotanist look at our material from the Chija site that we've worked at. And for people who are not familiar with the relatively complicated names for all these different things, basically the Panicum and Sitaria, those are millet. So the green bars on those are showing the actual like percentage counts of how much millet we're getting out of these sites. And millet is way over 60% of the assemblages that we're getting from our excavations here. Now at the bottom, Hortum and Traditium, that's wheat and barley. And so if you're looking at the green bars, wheat and barley are like bigger seeds. So weight-wise, the yellow bars, they're much higher. But as far as actual counts, we're much, much lower. So combined, less than 40% at this site. So we're not seeing that much of a change. It's not like wheat and barley are starting to dominate the diet during the Chija period. If anything, they're remaining but staying at a relatively low level. And I thought this was really interesting because it's not like these things came in and then they were outright rejected. It's not like they experimented with wheat and barley in the Magi-Yao, decided they didn't like it and stopped it. They kept growing it, but they kept growing it at a relatively low level. And I think this really speaks to sort of the agency of the farmers during this period, sort of like incorporating these new things into their diet, keeping incorporating them, but not changing their diet completely. So not getting rid of millet, not completely changing their diet in that way. And it also makes me think, what were they doing with wheat and barley? Was it for brewing? Was it for some other type of cuisine that we don't really understand? Unfortunately, there hasn't been any residue analysis done on any of the pottery from this area yet, which could give us a better idea of what was being stored in these jars and vessels and cooked and things like that. But I'm hoping that will be an avenue of future research. And that was the zooarchaeological data. And so this is an all in one slide here. Diato is the earlier Magi-Yao site we looked at. Chija Ping is the Chija site that we excavated at. Diato, pretty typical mid Neolithic assemblage. So the dark bar at the bottom, that is sheep and goats, so a little over 20%. Some of these might be wild, we're still trying to sort it out, but at least some domesticated in there. But the big chunk of white in the middle, that's pigs. So pigs dominating the diet, pretty unsurprising. At the top we have large bovines, which in this period we think are mostly like wild cattle, and possibly some deer in there as well. This site was really interesting that it has deer bones, but they're all worked. You get almost no like meat bones out of a deer. So we think maybe there was some like exchange going on too, where something was going out from Diato and deer, like worked deer bones coming in. Still trying to answer that question. But at Chija Ping, again, we get a rise in the amount of like sheep, goat that are showing up there, but it's not dominating the diet. It's still under 40%. Pigs are still much more common. So it's not this like shift towards pastoralism that has been proposed. It's not, again, a complete change of diet. Interestingly, the sheep are being used for all sorts of things. They're being eaten, but their bones are also being used for oracle bone, for pyromancy. So we actually came up with a number of oracle bones from our excavations, which was, I showed a picture of some earlier, but quite interesting. The data that I didn't talk about today, but I didn't cut off this chart just because it was interesting, is from the latest site we looked at, Weizuewa, which comes in a period after Chija. There it is, like, all sheep. It is sheep for days in this pit that we excavated there. So there does seem like maybe later on there was a big shift towards pastoralism, but it's really not what we're seeing during the Chija period. And so thinking about this data sort of all together, this is an illustration of sort of interactions that I think were going on during the Magi-Yao period, but as far as how connections were occurring between sites. And so during the Magi-Yao period, like I mentioned, funerals seem to have been a major location where exchange was potentially taking place, but then you also have day-to-day exchange or exchange of daily use sort of courseware pottery as well. And during this time period, we also have similar motifs over a relatively large area. And so thinking about, you know, how was this really occurring on a human scale? Well, if you have people going between sites with funerals, if you have people marrying people who live at other sites and moving out from their home site, maybe taking some of their pottery with them, and then if somebody dies, they go back and bring pottery with them again. So I'm really thinking of these relatively small to medium scale interactions that were going on. So people going one site to another, coming back around, and you really see this in motifs. So they spread out, and then some motifs come to dominate in different periods. Like, that can only occur if people are continually interacting. And then if you get things coming in like bronze in the north or jade carving from the east, people seem to be incorporating these into society as well. And it's not like it's making a complete change. People aren't abandoning stone tools for metal tools. They aren't carving jade at every site. You don't see jade showing up in elite jade-filled graves. You see an object here, an item there. At the cemetery at Qijiaping that was excavated in the 70s, that's where that turquoise inlaid bronze plaque that I showed earlier came from. That was in a tomb that had nothing else in it. It had like one pot in it with that. It wasn't bigger, it didn't have a coffin, it wasn't unusual in any way. And the same goes for jade. You get a piece here or a piece there, but it's not some sort of like transformative item, and it doesn't seem like it's being used in the same sort of elite context that we see in the East. And same with bronze working. You get an object here, an object there, and a grave, but nothing that's really seems to be a major change. And so I think, like, obviously some aspects of society were changing. People decided purposely to incorporate new styles of pottery, to incorporate new crops, but it's not like they abandoned all of their old traditions either. And so I think this sort of cultural change is much more nuanced than has been sort of given, than has been like thought about in recent literature on this topic. So that's the data that I have up to this point, and we're doing a few things to try to push these questions a bit further. So we're continuing our research in the Tao River Valley and starting to look at some new sites there. So this past year, we actually discovered a new site called Zhangguojia, which is one of the blue crosses there. Those are some photos from the site on the right, the fields we found it in, and some pottery coming out of a wall there. This seems to be a Qijia period site, and interestingly, it's located quite near to what was identified to us as a jade quarry, which I'll talk about more in a minute. And so we're starting to think more about, you know, with these new artifacts and technologies coming in, like jade working, like metal working, you know, how is that being incorporated into sort of the cultural life ways that already existed there? So were people carving jade themselves? Was it coming in as part of some sort of religious ritual? And how is this interacting with other craft production, with stone tool production, with pottery production on the landscape? So we're excited to start looking at that site. And then we're also looking at another site called Zhujiaping, which is from the Manjiao period, further south in the Tao River. So also trying to expand out the range. So the results we have are really all from sites within like a couple kilometers of one another. And now we want to see if these actually hold true on a larger scale. We've also been collaborating with colleagues at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, this new caste site up there. So these are a couple of sites where I actually did magnetometry survey, and then archaeologists from CAS, which is a national sort of institute for archaeology based out of Beijing, are now excavating based on the magnetometry survey there, and in turn we're getting to analyze some of the data and material coming up from their site. So hopefully this will give us a better idea of sort of whether these patterns we're seeing are being played out on a larger scale, at least within the Tao River Valley. I'm also really interested, or become more interested, in the landscapes within which these sites are situated. And so last year I did the first sort of geological survey of a river valley that is a tributary of the Tao that flows right in where two of the sites we were working at are. And so myself and some graduate students from the US and UK and China surveyed these valleys, looking both for archaeological sites. So we discovered 8 new Neolithic sites and like dozens of Han period and later sites, as well as taking geological and rock samples as we went along. And so I was collecting samples of clay and sand to try to understand, you know, where are some of those other outlier pottery recipes coming from? Where are the raw materials from that sort of thing located? We also have an expert on the project now who works with stone tools. And a lot of the stone tools we're seeing at these sites are not made of local river cobbles. They're made of things that get destroyed, or stones that get destroyed that don't last long in water. And so we're trying to figure out, you know, where the sources of schist and slate and gabbro that we're seeing showing up at stone tools at these sites coming from. So we've also been surveying up towards a couple mountainous areas on that survey to try to find sources for that, and we found several. And then also we were exploring more about this jade quarry that was mentioned to us by some local farmers there. So we surveyed up to that. Actually, that last Zhangguojia site that I just mentioned is the closest one yet discovered to this jade quarry. And locals there were saying, oh yeah, like back in the 60s and 70s, we used to find jade in the river all the time, and this site is, and like people have been working jade in this area for, you know, generations, until the water was diverted, and now the jade doesn't come down anymore, so nobody was very happy about that. But we went up to the mountain. There are clear traces of jade all over the place there, and even a quarry that's still sort of mined intermittently and illegally by some locals there, but we got to see that area as well. So we're really starting to think more about the intersection of production, how people would be moving across the landscapes and interacting with each other when they were going out to get these resources. Moving beyond the Tao River, I'm also working on a new collaboration at the Museum of Far Eastern Antiquities in Stockholm and with colleagues at Oxford University. So if you remember that photo of J.G. Anderson from the 1920s at the beginning of this, he was a Swede who was working in northwestern China, and his agreement with the government at the time was he could take all the material back for research, but two-thirds had to go back to China afterwards. He did return that. The one-third is left in Stockholm and has like never been examined since then. And this includes pottery from across the sites in the Northwest, many of which are no longer accessible. So to try to get it, you know, are these changes or lack of changes that I'm seeing occurring on a wider scale, we're also going to start research on those collections to try to see, is this also happening in other parts of Gansu and Qinghai and Ningxia, where these other sites are? And of course, excavating sites today is very expensive and long, and we already have these collections, so why not use them? And then my final research new research is taking place at a site called Shermao in Shanxi province. Curious, has anybody heard of this site? Okay, I'm sure you will, because this is basically like transforming our understanding of the early Bronze Age in China. So traditionally, in northern China, basically all the early states were seen as being located in the central plain, which is where later dynasties arose. This site is up in the very northern tip of Shanxi, and in an area that was long considered sort of this peripheral area where pastoralists lived, where there were no early states in the traditional sense. But in 2009, they started working at this site that is basically completely changing their understanding of what was going on in the region at the time. So the site dates to about 2300 to 1800 BC, and it has stone walls around the whole thing. So the red outline is the central stone wall, and then the yellow is the secondary wall that they found. This covers like 4 square kilometers that are enclosed. And then it also has like a stone citadel, so like this raised stone terraced fortress at one end of it, and then a like very complex stone gate facility as well. And so they've been excavating for 10 years, and the stuff they're finding is like stuff that shows up nowhere else in China at the time. So there's life-size eagle statues made of ceramic. That's the beak that's in my hand there. And then there's stone carving that I swear looks like it came out of the Maya world, although I think if you squint, maybe it can look like a later Tautier mask or something like that. So yeah, there's all sorts of stone carving, ceramic sculpture, bronze bracelets and things like that, skull pits, so clearly some coercive violence going on. This is the gate structure that's at the site. But along with all these crazy finds at Shermao, they've also uncovered like 10 million pieces of pottery, none of which have been analyzed aside from general typology yet. And so I'm going to be doing the first petrographic analysis of that material. And they actually have a lot of pottery that looks like Qijia material. So I'm very curious to see if it's purely a stylistic similarity or there was actually much longer distance interaction potentially going on at these time periods, either through exchange, like down the line exchange, or actual longer distance things. So those are kind of the new directions I'm pushing the research in with my colleagues. And I thank you very much to the various funding organizations and for you all for coming out tonight. I appreciate it.